Dateline 1986, place Chernobyl, in the heart of the Ukraine where a nuclear reactor exploded, releasing 400 times more radiation than the bomb that hit Hiroshima. 30 people died and 50,000 fled their homes. Radioactive fallout spread to an area larger than Long Island, making it a virtual no man's land. The plant was encased under a giant dome, but now, 30 years later, that dome is crumbling, and Chernobyl's threat is once again imminent as another potential disaster looms. Let's take a look.
Deadly radiation is being released from the damaged plant.
Chernobyl, a catastrophic nuclear disaster, threatens again.
Don't stop. Quickly.
Now, engineers build a massive structure to prevent another radioactive crisis.
It's the biggest movable structure in the world.
It's extremely dangerous.
Building Chernobyl's mega tunnel on Nova.
Now, more than 30 years later, there are many questions still lingering about what exactly happened the night of the tragedy. Here to bring us some insight is Adam Higginbotham, who is the author of Midnight in Chernobyl. Adam, it's nice to have you here with us.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
I have to tell you, this reads like a novel. It's like a mystery disaster novel. Which I hope is a compliment.
That was definitely the idea.
Good.
Yeah.
Well, you achieved it. First question, as I guess most authors, is what drew you to this story and to make you decide, all right, it's time now to write this?
Well, my reporting on the story goes back quite a long way to 2006, because I initially went to Russia and Ukraine to write a magazine story. And at that point, I was just interested in reconstructing the events through the accounts of eyewitnesses that I'd found. But when I began talking to them, I realized that there was a lot more to the story than I had known about, and that was accounted for in books that had been written up to that point. And so then I knew that there was a fuller account to be written. And then I went back again in 2011 for another story. And at that point, this was about a totally different aspect of the accident, about the ecological consequences of what happened, and about the exclusion zone and the wildlife in the exclusion zone, because there was this idea that it had become kind of a radioactive safari park where animals thrived in spite of radiation. So I was reporting on that. And at that point, I did some things during the course of reporting, went to places where I just thought it frightened me so much, I swore I would never go back again. And then about 3 years later, I found myself sitting at my desk here in New York and thinking, well, actually, there's this other part of the story that maybe I could. And at that point, I realized that, you know, I had to write a book about it.
Because it had you.
It had you,
exactly.
And it had pulled you into it.
Yeah.
When you said you went back and you were surprised by things,
mm-hmm.
What was it that you think, let's focus first on the event itself and the follow-up, the initial attempt to cover up. Did you learn things about that you had not known before through your other reporting?
Well, that was one of the main points that drew me in back in 2006 when I realized that what I, even the reading that I'd done, and I'd read a lot of stuff before I went to begin reporting in Russia and Ukraine. One of the standard questions I asked all the eyewitnesses I met back in 2006 was, what for you was the most frightening moment of these events? Obviously, I expected, you know, people to say, well, I was in the building and there was this tremendous explosion and I didn't know what had happened. I thought the war with the Americans had begun, you know, which is what one person said to me. There's this one guy who was a physicist who had enormous experience working in the Soviet nuclear industry and the complex around the USSR. And I asked him this question. He didn't say that. He said, well, for me, the most frightening moment was probably around May the 5th or May the 6th when me and all the other physicists around the plant at that point thought that there was going to be a second explosion that was going to be even more massive than the first, and we were all going to die. So at that point, I just thought, wait, how did I not know about this? And that, I mean, that to me was the most surprising thing that I found out.
You talk about in the book a number of things, and one of the things you talk about is that the notion that this should have been predictable. People should have been able to see the chances of this happening. Why do you think that was?
Well, because one of the roots, the roots of the disaster go back into the structure and the nature of the Soviet Union. It was, you know, a state built on secrecy and lies. But the proximate causes of the disaster were these design faults in the reactor. And the people that had built and designed the reactor knew about these faults for more than 10 years before the accident happened. So that alone, you know, is an indication that there were certainly people within the nuclear industry and within the Ministry of Medium Machine Building, which was this, you know, monolithic ministry of the Soviet Union that ran not only the atom weapons program, but also all of the nuclear fuel cycle for civilian stations. And those people knew that there were these problems with the reactor, but they covered them up, minimized them, and kept details of them even from the people who operated the plants.
Let's talk about your visits back in Chernobyl now.
Mm-hmm.
And I was struck by the fact that there were so many people that are still alive that had been in there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you mentioned some of them are still, at least one's still involved in the nuclear industry, the nuclear power industry.
Oh, definitely. I mean, that was something that I was surprised by right at the beginning 12 years ago. You know, I thought that I would find people who were kind of peripheral to events. But, you know, among the first people I met were people who were actually inside the plant at the instant of the explosion, and not only survived that, but then had survived until the present day. And there's one guy, Boris Stolyachuk, who I interviewed a couple of times, who was in the control room at the moment of the explosion. And he not only survived, but then went back to work in the nuclear industry, and then recently was appointed the acting head of the Ukrainian Nuclear Safety Board.
How about the aftermath? Let's talk medically, mm-hmm. the people who had been in the plant, the people around the plant. What did you find about that?
Well, I mean, the people who received the worst levels of exposure in the hours and days after the explosion, you know, they received very severe radiation injuries, and many of them, the 30 people that you mentioned,
right,
those are the people who died. You know, other people were affected but recovered. So there were some people I spoke to who spent months in hospital. Mm. But eventually their health recovered, and then, you know, they merely had to live with the long-term consequences of what had happened. So they would keep going for treatment and skin grafts and had to remain on medication, be careful what they did. And those people could never return to work, you know, at a nuclear plant because of their existing radiation exposure. But if you're asking more broadly about people in the wider population, right, you know, there were 5 million people living in the areas that were worst affected in Ukraine, in Belarus, in Ukraine. And really no kind of comprehensive long-term study of their health has ever been done. It's been done piecemeal. So at this point, partly because of that and partly because the Soviet government attempted to cover up and, again, minimize the true effects of what had happened, we will probably never know what the health consequences of the accident for those people are.
Well, Adam, as I said in the beginning, it's a marvelous read. Does indeed read like a novel, and certainly tells us so much. Even people, as you said, who thought they knew everything there was to know, right, about Chernobyl will be shocked when they realize how much they didn't know. Midnight in Chernobyl, the untold story of the world's greatest nuclear disaster. Thanks for spending some time with us.
Thank you.
Appreciate it, and congratulations on some great work.
Thank you.
Be well.